Good morning, friends. Welcome back. Myself, Dr. Gibran Ahmed, presents to you Simply Pathology, and today we are back with a very, very important topic. So without wasting any time, let us start. Today we are going to discuss about the new MBBS curriculum which was introduced by the Board of Governors in 2019. So the National Medical Council, as you know, has come into play, and the Medical Council of India, that is the MCI, okay, it has been dissolved. So although this has happened, you should note that this new curriculum, okay, was designed by the Board of Governors, okay, when the MCI was still alive. So this new MBBS curriculum has a lot of changes, and I would request everyone, okay, to watch till the end of this video to have a complete idea. This is going to be a very beneficial video and an eye-opener video for everyone, every MBBS aspirant as well as every new MBBS student. So the first major change that has occurred in our MBBS is that there is a reduction in the duration of the MBBS from usual 54 months, that is 4.5 years, that is 4 years, 6 months, to 50 months, that is 4 years, 2 months. So there has been a complete reduction of 4 months. And this reduction has been done mainly in the second MBBS. In our time when we were students, in our second MBBS, okay, our second MBBS was around 1.5 years, around 18 months. Now that has been reduced to 11 months. Okay, so let us see the new MCI curriculum, how we are having the different subjects and how everything is there. Okay, so the first year is around 13 months. Usually first year was for 12 months. 1 month has been increased, and that is because they have introduced a foundation course. We are going to discuss in details about the foundation course. Stay tuned. Now the first year subjects, as you know, we are having anatomy, physiology and the biochemistry. So these are the same. Nothing has changed over here. If you look at the second year, the duration has drastically been reduced. From 18 months, it has been reduced to 11 months. Now the subjects also has some changes. I will tell you. We are having pathology, pharmacology, microbiology, but they have introduced PSM, that is preventive and social medicine, in the second year itself. Usually PSM was there only in the third year, but now they have introduced that in the second year itself, because the preventive medicine is a very, very important topic to know, and they have chosen to introduce that early in the course. Now the third part, okay, the duration is the same, but the subjects have a little bit of changes. PSM is continuing into the third year, but an extra subject that was for second year, that is forensic medicine, has been added to third first. So now the subjects are ENT, ophthalmology, PSM, and in addition we are having forensic medicine. So PSM is there both in third, in second year as well as in third first. Now in the third second part, the duration in my time it was around 12 months, but now it has been increased to 14 months. And the four important subjects in the final year is medicine, pediatrics, surgery and obstetric gynecology. Now all these subjects like psychiatry, dermatology, radiology, these are allied subjects for medicine, and orthopedics, anesthesia, these are allied subjects for surgery. Now once you are going to complete these 4 years, you see you don't have an extra amount of time, and you have to sit for the next one, that is the pre-internship national exit exam, which is the theory based MCQ exam. This, after you successfully qualify this exam, you will have a 1 year compulsory rotatory internship, and this will be followed by the national exit exam, that is a practical exam, that is the next two exam. So only after you clear the next two that you will be eligible to practice in India. Okay. So one important thing that I want to tell you is that, yes, before I go further, I want to tell you that a link has been provided, okay, which will give you an access to the complete syllabus for all the 19 subjects, including the allied subjects, in the description box. So please don't forget to go through the description box and to see all the syllabus. Okay. So how should you go about your preparation for the university exams as well as next? So for this, I have to go back to this. So as you can see, As you can see in this particular diagram, you will realize one thing, that you don't have much time. Okay, before I say much time, just I want to clear one thing to everyone. Although the duration of the course has been reduced from 4.5 years to 4 years, 2 months, I would like to emphasize that this amount of time is enough for your MBBS. Okay, for learning your subjects, you are having enough time. This is all right. Secondly, one important thing is that irrelevant parts of the theory, okay, they have been removed. Okay, unnecessary irrelevant parts, technical parts, which are basically theory based. So there has been a reduction in the curriculum. There has been a reduction in the amount that you have to read in this curriculum. Okay, so don't worry about that. Even the syllabus has been made more concise, okay, and more application based, medicine and clinical based syllabus has been made. So don't worry, this amount of time is adequate. Okay, but you have to take care of one thing. If you want to go, because in today's world, okay, post graduation is must. It is not desirable, it is must. Okay, you have to do a post graduation. So I would like to tell you something. Even one important thing is that you know that the exit exam is also very important for passing MBBS. Okay, for the licentiate exam, for practicing in India, you need to pass also. So one thing you have to understand, that this national exit exam will test not only the final year subjects, it is going to test all the 4 years. So what is very important over here, that after or at the end of every year, you will have to be ready with your notes. The time has gone that you will think that after 4 years of my education, I will at the end of the third year, I am going to revise all the other subjects. No, you will not be able to do that. And if you are like that, if you're thinking in that term, that no, that I am going to do everything in the end, then you will be in big trouble. Okay, I am not trying to scare you. I'm just trying to show you the reality. Okay, so the approach, what I would have done, myself would have done. So for example, in the first year, you're reading anatomy, physiology, biochemistry, okay, along with these subjects, I would solve all the relevant MCQs. Okay, I will solve all the MCQs that I can for the first year. Okay, and secondly, I will make notes which are based on such MCQs, and conceptual notes will be made. Notes that is small, that is reproducible. Okay, and that will be ready by the end of the first year. Similarly, in the second year, I am also going to make the notes for respective subjects. But in addition, in the end of the second year, I am going to revise my subjects for the first year. When I go to the third year, I will have my different subjects like forensic, ENT, ophthal, PSM. I am going to again solve the MCQs and make notes. And at the end of this 12 months, I am going to try to revise the basic sciences as well. It may not be very easy to revise all the subjects, but at least some of those subjects which were difficult, which is volatile, which I cannot recall, at least I am going to see those important and difficult topics. So that you can only do once your notes are ready. If you haven't prepared your notes in first year, second year, in third year, you will not have time to go and read the textbooks of first and second year. Now for the final part two, now as it is, medicine, pediatrics, okay, surgery and obstetrics, these are vast subjects. Okay, so trust me, in the final MBBS itself, you will not have enough time. And in that point of time, maybe you will get 1 month or 1.5 month you are going to take out. In that 1.5 month, you will have to revise everything from the first, second and third MBBS. Okay, so in this time, okay, you will only be able to revise if you have made the notes and if you have practiced the MCQs well in advance before. Then and only then you will be able to sit for your next one exam, and then you will be confident about it. Else everything is going to be haphazard. So this is how I would approach, and this is how I encourage you all to approach next one exam, especially the MBBS students who are studying in India as well as abroad. Okay, this I have already discussed, that a link has been provided, and this I have already discussed how you should go about your preparation for university exam as well as next. So the first thing that I want to tell you is that Everything about this new curriculum is competency-based undergraduate curriculum for the Indian medical graduate. What do you mean by competency-based? Means there is a competency, means either you are competent in something or you are not competent. So first you have to read about that competency. What is that competency? Okay, for example, a blood pressure. Okay, so you read in physiology, what is the blood pressure? How is the blood pressure? How is the blood pressure maintained? Okay, then in pathology, you read about hypertension. Okay, or hypotension. Okay, conditions where you have hyper and hypotension, you read about the pathology. Then you saw how to measure the blood pressure. Okay, you should know how to measure the blood pressure. For example, you will have a patient, okay, in your exam, and you will have to go and measure the blood pressure. And for example, the blood pressure came high. So whether you have the knowledge about what is the blood pressure, whether you have the knowledge related to the diseases associated with an alteration of blood pressure, and whether you know how to take the blood pressure of a patient, and also not only taking the blood pressure, also you know to comprehend whether the blood pressure is normal or abnormal, whether you can make a clinical correlation, okay, and whether you are able to treat that, whether you are able to give some drugs to lower the blood pressure. So this is what is competency. So everything in this MBBS curriculum is competency based. Whether you are competent enough to carry out a basic process, a procedure, and you have a basic understanding of the clinical correlation, okay, with the basic sciences. So the first, what we are going to discuss in this particular lecture are the 4-5 things. One is the early clinical exposure program that has been introduced. Second is the foundation course that is new, that wasn't there before but has been introduced in the first year. Third, we are going to discuss about alignment and integration, okay, that has been stressed upon, is very important. And lastly is ATCOM, that is attitude, ethics and communication. Remember one thing, I am going to discuss this in the end. And remember, some questions will be based on attitude, ethics and communication, and that will be present in your university exams and in all the next one, next to all these things, this will form an important part. So please see this video till the end so you don't miss ATCOM. And this I have already discussed, that the irrelevant parts of the old syllabus has been removed now. So the first thing that we are going to discuss is the early clinical exposure program. So the MBBS curriculum has been modified so that the clinical exposure can be introduced from the first year itself. Initially, what happened, that basically from second year the clinical exposure started, but it wasn't that much serious. Only in third year that we saw that we had a good amount of clinical exposure, and only by the time we used to come in the final year that we saw the patients, seriously we were interested in clinical postings. But now from the first year itself, you will be given a basic exposure to the clinical program. You have certain number of hours, that is okay. So the basic, there are three basic components of this. One is biclinical correlation. The first important thing is that you will be able to clinically correlate. So for example, if you are reading about a particular subject, for example, you're reading physiology, or you are in second year, you're reading pathology. So you saw a patient, for example, you are reading about the heart, okay, in first year. Then in the first year in physiology, you're reading about heart, and then one applied part of that is heart failure. So now what will happen, that for example, your preclinical or your clinician or the clinical counterpart, okay, they will arrange for you to see a patient, okay, of heart failure. So from the first year itself, you can see the patient, how a patient of a heart failure is presenting. Okay, what are the clinical symptoms? What are the signs? What is the patient distress? Okay, what are the drugs that the patient is getting, and all things. So you will have quite an interest about such patients. Okay, so once you see the practical aspect of the medicine, then what will happen, you will become more interested, your mind will open a lot. So, and you will be able to clinically correlate. What is the meaning of clinical correlation? Whatever you are reading in the textbooks, whether some of these findings or whether all of these findings you are getting in the practical world or no. So just mugging up will not do. Whether only when you see the patients, and when you see that, yes, whatever I am reading in the book, I am watching the same thing. Whatever clinical signs are given in the book, I am being able to elicit those signs in the patient. Okay. Okay, that is the clinical correlation. Okay, so once this habit is inculcated from the very beginning, when you have such an habit, when you develop such an habit, then in the final year when you go, you are very comfortable with the clinical, okay, with the clinics. Second, a provision of an authentic human contact in a social or clinical context. What is important? So you read a book, okay, and you directly go and you see the patient. No. When you go and see the patient, you will see that there are certain family members. Okay, you need to have some ethics. Okay, it's not like you go, for example, a group of 50 people go and suddenly you drop on the patient and you examine. Everyone want to examine. No, it's not that way. There are certain ways, there is certain, you should have respect. Patient should be like God to you. So the kind of attitude you should have towards the patient, okay, is also important. And how you should communicate with the family members is also very important. So this will help you, because you will see how the clinicians are talking to the patient, how the clinicians are talking to the family members, how they are eliciting the history from the patient. All these things are forming a very important part. So so this is the second important element. And third is the humanities, which also comes. How your behavior should be, how you should behave, on what your behavior towards the community is. Okay, so you will be introduced to this program very early from the first year itself. Now the foundation course. So as I told you that 1 month will be the foundation course. I remember in my time when I was in my MBBS, we just have 3 days of foundation course and we were just taken to the anatomy, physiology, biochemistry department and that's it. 1 day anatomy, 1 day biology, physiology, 1 day biochemistry. That's it. That was the foundation for 3 days. Okay. But over here, they have a robust, foundation course amounting to around 175 hours. So the foundation course will be a 1 month duration course and that will be introduced at the first year of the MBBS course. And the basic goal of this foundation course is to acclimatize, okay, to make you comfortable with this new professional environment, okay. And this is very important because you should have an idea, okay, why you are coming over here, okay, what all you will be learning over here and what all is important. So you will get a direction that what I have to do as a student to become a doctor and what really the job is, okay, what your job is, what is expected of you. You will also know this, so you will have an approach, you will have an aim while you read, okay. So it will provide a sound foundation for not only learning in the MBBS course but also later on in the professional career, okay. So there are many modules, okay. I will just go through very fast. So first of all, there is an orientation program wherein you will be giving an introduction to the institution, the campus, the facilities which are available so that you can make good use of that. Then what is the role of a doctor in a society? So you might have some preformed notion you might have from beforehand about what a doctor is. Just 99% of people who are going in this medical field, they go with the thinking that they want to earn money, but they don't know what all they have to do to be a doctor. So the role of doctor in the society, how the doctor should act in the society, okay, it is also very important. So that you should know. Then the history of medicine, then the role of IMG, Indian Medical Graduate roles, and overview of the MBBS curriculum, that what I am giving you right now. And the principles of family practice. Yes, you are a community doctor. You have heard many times that when you treat, okay, some people in your society, you not only treat that particular individual, you treat his wife, you treat them children. So you have the basic knowledge of the entire family. So you are not only a basic doctor, you are a family doctor and a doctor is a social being, a very big social being that is in our community. Second thing is the skills. So there are certain basic skills that even a medical student should know. What is first aid? First aid means what? If you see, if you are a medical student, something happens in the road, what is the first aid that you shall give? You will not say that, no, I'm just a student, I cannot do anything. No, it's not like that. At least the first aid you should be able to give. What is BLS? What is the basic life support? You should be accustomed and trained in that. What are the universal precautions? How you should manage the waste? The waste management, because in every year, first year, second year, third year, fourth year, in all these years, some kind of waste is generated. So how you will manage them? The immunization program, basics of the immunization program and the importance of documentation, okay, for everything, for every in the field of medicine, as you see, the number of medical legal cases have increased. So the importance of documentation cannot be emphasized enough. Also, there will be community orientation. Now, I want to tell you to all the first year MBBS, this is also your orientation through me. There are a number of national health programs in preventive and social medicine. You are going to read about many programs, but in this foundation course, you will be, for example, there is a DOTS program for tuberculosis. Okay, there is a national AIDS control program. There is a national program for control of blindness. So there are number of programs that has been formed by the government of India. So you should be very sound with those, because all these services are being provided. There is a cervical screening program. There is a breast screening program that is going on. So you have, so unless and until you have the knowledge of this program, you cannot guide your patients in your community that yes, so and so program is going on. Go and get yourself tested. Go and take the vaccine, go and take this. So you yourself have to be very sound. So from the preventive and social medicine aspect, this also has been introduced from the first year. Now, how you should interact with the patients and the families and the communities, this is also very important. So community orientation program will be there. Then there will be a professional development and ethics module of 40 years. So as you know that in India, there has not only in India, in around the world also, and especially in India, there has been a rise in the number of violence against the doctors. So there are many aspects. There are sometimes there is a fault of the doctor. There are sometimes the fault is for the patients. So there is a social, there is a technical, professional, there is a lot of gap between the doctors and the patient. So to address those particular things, we will have to have a basic module. So what is the concept of professionalism and ethics? So a doctor has to be a professional, yet he has to be polite and social towards his patients. Okay, then the behavior, the attitude of the doctor, how you should work in a healthcare team. Okay, the cultural competence, the stress management, how you have to manage your time, interpersonal relationship, as well as learning. All these things are very, very important and will form a basic foundation course. Okay, at the end of this foundation course, a very important thing is the language and communication. So actually, when I was in my MBBS, okay, in every MBBS college, if you see, students are coming from all over India, even from different countries, they are coming to read. So first they are going, they don't know the local language. So it is very, very important that you have to learn the local language. For example, I am basically a Bengali and I read my MBBS in Maharashtra. So I had to read Marathi. At least few important words you will have to know so that you can interact with the patients. This because it is very important, because if you are going in the clinical posting, language, the local language, you have to learn and understand so that you can actually speak with the patient. You can have a communication with the patient. And you know that in our medical practice, communication is very important. Okay. Also, even after you know the language, how you have to communicate, okay, with not only with the patients, with your superiors, with your inferiors, with everyone, not inferiors, with your the ones who are working under you. For example, the nurse, the ward boys, the sweepers, everyone. Okay, so you have to develop a communication skill with everyone. Now, because our entire course is based in English language, so English language is must. Many of the students, they are coming from Hindi medium or other cultural, for example, Gujarati medium, Bengali medium. They had English language as a second, okay, not the first. And also in this era of technical era, okay, where all of you are having a tablet or a laptop and you are having the entire courses you're reading from, gone are the days when you read from the textbooks. Now you all are reading from the PDFs and everything. So you should have a knowledge of how to operate the computer also. So with technology which is coming up, you should be, well versed with your computer skills. This is yes. Also, they have introduced one very important thing, that sports and extracurricular activities are also necessary. As you see, the sports has been mandatory for 4 hours per week and extracurricular activities 2 hours per week for a subject to a total of 22 hours. Now, the two important things that I want to tell you is alignment and integration. So first, we will understand what is alignment. Alignment simply means that teaching a particular subject material that occurs under a particular organ system or disease from the same phase in the same time frame. So what is the meaning? That is temporal education. For example, you are reading cardiovascular system in anatomy. Now, the college or basically yourself should do one thing, that along with that you will have lectures in physiology for cardiovascular system, and in biochemistry also certain parameters which are associated with the CVS or the cardiovascular system should be taught. So all these three topics will be in alignment. In anat, physio and biochemistry, all the three subjects will teach you the same thing. That is alignment. For example, syllabus in the cardiovascular system or the respiratory system in anatomy, physiology and biochemistry can be scheduled simultaneously in the timetable. Okay? And this occurs in the same time frame, means in the same day you will be having lectures of CVS in all these three subjects. So it is occurring in that same time frame. Another important example of alignment is, for example, the pancreas is having different kinds of cells. So we know we are having alpha, beta and we are having delta cells. So pancreatic beta cell anatomy, histology, pancreatic beta cell physiology and insulin structure, and so basically the pancreatic beta cell anatomy and histology. So in anatomy we are going to read the anatomy and the histology of the pancreatic beta cell. Okay. Secondly, the pancreatic beta cell physiology. What is the physiology of that? And the insulin structure and synthesis in the biochemistry. They are usually taught at different times of the year. In our time was like this. But an effort should be made that all these three topics are taught together. So this is also an example of alignment. In the same time frame, you are reading all these things together. That is what alignment is. When suppose there is a basic organ system or anything, okay, you should try to read the anatomy, physiology and the biochemistry part together. So in this way you are going to learn better, and in this way also, instead of reading them separately, you are reading them together. So even the time period is reduced. You don't have to read about one thing 1,000 times. Okay, so you read about something once only, that's it. Now, the second important concept is integration. What is integration? Integration actually is, for example, you are reading 4, 5, 6 subjects. Okay. Or for example, you read anatomy, physiology, or you are reading pathology now in second year. Okay. So you are reading something about anatomy. Okay. And then you are reading the same, and you are reading some applied aspects of that in pathology. Then you integrate these two subjects. Okay, so you are taking a meaning out of the entire thing together. Okay, also for example, if you are reading anatomy and you are having some applied part in physiology, okay, then you are also aligning these two subjects, you are also integrating them. So when you integrate them horizontally, means across the same subjects of the same year, for example, you are applying the concepts of anatomy and physiology and biochemistry or vice versa, then it is called as horizontal integration. But for example, if you are correlating anatomy with radiology, okay, anatomy with pathology or physiology with pathology, that is a vertical between different subjects of the different years, between first year, second year, third year, fourth year. So if you are correlating or integrating the subjects of different years together, that is vertical integration. So basically integration must be horizontal, that is across the disciplines in a given phase of the course, and vertical, that is across the different phases of the course, that is between the first year, second year, third year, fourth year. So horizontal and vertical integration. Okay, so horizontal integration is conceptual integration among subjects of the same year, as I already mentioned, and vertical integration is stressing conceptual relations among subjects of different years. For example, anatomy and radiology, anatomy and surgery. For example, anatomy and orthopedics, you are correlating that. Okay. So vertical integration is stressing conceptual. Okay, so by introducing the clinical postings from the first year itself, the students will learn to integrate the subjects of the MBBS from the first year itself. You are going to correlate. Okay, integration, as I already said, it implies that concepts in a topic or organ system that are similar, overlapping or redundant are merged into a single teaching session in which subject-based demarcations are removed. Now, this is very, very important. Okay, so for example, you are reading anatomy, you have taken respiratory system. Again, in physiology, you have some you are reading respiratory system, and they have included some portion of anatomy over there. So now if you read separately, a teacher of anatomy will teach you the entire anatomy, a teacher of physiology again will teach you anatomy, again will teach you, again in medicine also, if you read that topic again, they are going to teach you anatomy. So by taking all these subjects together, for example, if the teacher of anatomy and teacher of physiology, they decide, okay, now both of us are going to teach one subject together. Okay, so the repetition is going to be reduced. That is why we have reduced the curriculum. So repetitions are not there. So there are three parts of integration, that is sharing, correlation and nesting. So what is very important, what is sharing? For example, there is a significant overlap in the liver function, okay, in physiology and bilirubin metabolism and biochemistry. So two departments could share the session, thereby reducing the repetition in what is being taught. Okay, so this is what is called as a sharing. So you, why it is important for the students? Because you have to realize the questions that is going to be asked to you will be like that. Okay, they are not only going to ask you separate question for physiology, separate question for biochemistry. No, they are going to mix both of them in a single question, and then they are going to ask you one question. This is the sharing. This is integration by sharing. Okay, now in the second example, for example, in a session on bilirubin metabolism, a patient, okay, with a Duane-Johnson syndrome is nested as a short discussion to provide an understanding of what can go wrong. So what has happened that I have taken a topic from biochemistry, and in medicine, clinically, a patient is present in the ward of a Duane-Johnson syndrome. So what will happen? A clinical doctor with a preclinical doctor, they can speak with each other and they can arrange for a lecture for the students. This is called as nesting. Okay, so here you are studying about certain concepts in biochemistry and the same concepts you are studying in medicine. Okay, and the clinician and the pre-clinician, they can have a lecture together. This is nesting, wherein two different subjects you are integrating both of them. The third is correlation. For example, a patient with a type 1 diabetes is used to understand the functions of the pancreatic islet secretion and metabolism. So this is called as correlation study. So you have seen, you have read about all the findings that you see in diabetic patient. You read about that in physiology, in pathology, you read about that. Now again, you are watching a patient of type 1 diabetes mellitus. You see all the reports, all the parameters, the laboratory reports, and then you correlate. You relate whether all the findings that I am seeing in person as in the patient, whether those findings are correlating with whatever findings are present in the book. That is the correlation. So this is integration by correlation. Now as students, you will ask me, sir, why are you telling me all this? This is for the teachers to take care of. Why I am telling you from before is that this is the way you have to read also, whether the teacher will tell you or not, but this is how the question will be asked. That is why you will have to develop an approach that how I have to read. That is why you have to read with sharing, nesting and correlation. This is how you should have an approach towards your medical subjects. Now, all of you who are yet watching the videos, you will gain the most benefit and you will reap the rewards of EDCOM. EDCOM has been introduced in the MBBS for the first time as a separate entity. Attitude, ethics and communication, these competencies will be tested not only in first, second, third, fourth year. Means this is present in the first year, second year, third year, fourth year. Throughout the MBBS curriculum, you will be taught about this EDCOM competencies. Okay, and the questions will be asked from these, a significant amount of questions from EDCOM will be asked to you in your next one as well as next two. So this is very, very important component of the MBBS curriculum. No one is going to speak to you about this. No one will. And most of you, I think, most of you will think, oh, this is basic, simple thing. But this is the most scoring part of your exams, the EDCOM. They have a separate section on EDCOM, and the PDF for this EDCOM that is prepared by NMC, I have shared that in the description box. So the international medical graduate, they must be able to function appropriately, ethically, effectively in his or her roles as a clinician, leader and member of the healthcare team and system, communicator, lifelong learner and as a professional. So the domains of attitude and communication, okay, with emphasis on ethics, therefore needs to be taught directly and explicitly throughout the undergraduate curriculum. Throughout means in all the 4 years you will be having this. So what is very important over here, before I go, attitude. It is very important that you are competent as a doctor. What you have to do at what point of time, that is very important. In India, we are learning about everything, but we do not have the resources. So whatever resources are available, we have to act accordingly. So we have to make the best use of resources in the Indian setting. Whatever you are reading in the books and whatever you see in reality in our country in India is quite different. So you have to have an attitude. You should be a professional. Okay, you should be a professional. You should know how to see the patient. You should know how to examine the patient. You should know, you should be fast enough to make a decision, a split second decision, and you should give a diagnosis. You should start the treatment as soon as possible. So this is what is the attitude. This is how you have to develop the attitude. The ethics, a very important part that in today's world, our doctors are lacking, especially the Indian doctors. The ethics towards the patient, how you should approach a patient, how you should be empathetic towards the patient. Empathetic means what? Means the patient's pain, you should at least show to the patient that you are having some kind of sympathy towards the patient, towards the family member, not shouting towards the patient. Okay, you have to explain, you have to be patient. You know everything about the medicine. The patient doesn't know everything about the medicine. So you have to be very patient with the patient itself. You have to know the third part is the communication. You have to have, this is a very important skill. I say in today's world, a doctor who cannot communicate is no doctor at all. Yes, even if he is a gold medalist, if he cannot communicate with the patient, he is not a doctor. Communication is a very important part of being a doctor. And mind it, all these three things you will be tested upon in this new curriculum, in next one and in next two. No one is talking about this. No coaching institute, no consultancy, no one is talking about ITCOM. Why? Because for them, next one is just a theory based exam. Next two is just a practical based exam. Just going to clinics, posting, everything is over. This is enough. No. This is a very important part and a scoring part. So a clinician is the one who understands and provides not only your treatment, but the preventive, promotive, curative, palliative and holistic care with compassion. Then he is a leader and member of the healthcare team. So for example, in India, if you see, there are multiple PHC, a primary healthcare center, wherein there is one MBBS doctor, and along with that MBBS doctor, you are having one nurse, one class D, a group D worker, a sweeper, that's it. And maybe one or two more staff, and you have to manage the primary healthcare system. So you have to manage, you are not only a doctor, you are also a management person. You have to manage the stock, the medicines, you have to manage everything, whether it is available or no. You have to manage the people who was there, the community that you are working in, the village that you are working in. You have to have a management skill towards that. So you have to manage your healthcare team. You have to be a communicator among your colleagues, means with the sister, with the nurses, with the ward boys, with the sweepers, everyone. You have to communicate very well with the patients and the families. Again, you have to be a lifelong learner. Okay, even you have cracked the next one, next two, you have become a doctor now. Is that over? No. The medical field is an ever-changing field. Okay, you have to be a lifelong learner, committed to continuous improvement of your skills and knowledge. And lastly, you have to be professional, committed to excellence. You have to be ethical. You have to be responsible. And the most important thing is you have to be accountable. Whatever you are doing, you have to be accountable. You do everything thinking that you have to give an explanation for what you are thinking, not blindly doing anything. Okay. So these are the most important jewels from this video lecture that you are going to take away today. So these are the type of clinical scenarios that you will be presented in your exams in next one and next two, the clinical based scenarios. These are the ETCOMs. Okay. For example, a 53 year old man is seen by a cardiologist for chest pain lasting for a few minutes on accustomed exercise for the past 3 weeks. Now, after detailed history and physical examination, the doctor is ordering an ECG, which was normal. Now he further orders an exercise, a stress test. A stress test is, for example, the person is made to run in a treadmill, and then the ECG is taken. So on that, he sees that there is a reversible ischemia. There is some kind of obstruction to the flow of blood. Okay, when there is an exertion. So the doctor orders an angiogram. At the time, the patient requests that he would like to have a second opinion. Second opinion means that he wants to take an opinion from another doctor. So the cardiologist then explains that he has done everything correctly and that the patient indeed requires an angiogram. The patient tells him that he cannot make a decision unless he talks to his family doctor of 20 years. So the cardiologist is offended and tells the patient that he does not wish to see the patient any longer. So this is what a clinical scenario is. So there are many aspects to this basic scenario. Whether what the doctor is doing is wrong, and what the patient is saying, whether he is wrong, no, a second opinion, every patient has a right for a second opinion. So there is something called as a doctor-patient relationship, which you are going to read in your MBBS curriculum, in FMC, in forensic medicine science, you are going to read. What are the rights of the patient and what are the duties of a doctor? You have to know these points. Okay, does the request for a second opinion provide sufficient ground to terminate the doctor-patient relationship? Okay, is that true? Is that right? No, absolutely not. So you have to be well versed in some situations like this. There are certain legal aspects also about this. So this is just to, you know, these are the real life situations that you will face as a doctor. So in that situation, how you should react, you should know from before. Let us take a second example. A young doctor has been taking care of an 86-year-old woman for the past 2 years. She had a fall 2 years ago and had mostly been bedridden. Now she is living alone and with just a caretaker, and her children are abroad. Now she requires a preventive care mostly, and the doctor makes house visits once a week. Now the doctor spends time talking to her during each visit and makes her feel comfortable. One day during such a visit, the patient expresses the view that her children have been ungrateful to her and that she intends to call her lawyer today only and divide her assets between the doctor and the caretaker after that. Now see this situation. All the situation will not be taught to you in medical career, but what the doctor should do, what is the point of discussion? So what are the boundaries in this doctor-patient relationship? Again, this is a very important topic of discussion. I will give you the links for all these answers in the end of the video. So the trust and the vulnerability in the doctor-patient relationship. So it is very important that as a doctor, you should know where you have to draw a line. What is the boundary? Okay, how you have to react in such situations? Absolutely, you will not accept this as a doctor. Any gift, anything from the patient is not acceptable to the doctor. Okay. So the answer to this, that is the previous one that I have asked you, the answer has been given by the AMA Code of Medical Ethics. You go to this particular site, copy this to the URL and just see the answer. Go and see the explanation over there. Now for the second one, again, the link has been provided. You can go and see the answers. Okay. Now the third case is the cover-up case. Now you are evaluating a person called as Mrs. Lakshmi Srinivasan, who is a 48-year-old woman presenting with lymphadenopathy. Now she had been complaining of mild fever and weight loss for the past 4 to 5 months. Examination of the neck is showing large rubbery lymph nodes that are present also in the axilla and the groin. Now there is a palpable spleen also. Now she is accompanied by her caring husband. Now Lakshmi undergoes a lymph node biopsy and the pathologist calls you and tells you that she has a lymphoma. Now that evening, Mr. Srinivasan comes in first into your office and leaves the report on your table. As you read the description, you realize that the final diagnosis has been altered to tuberculosis by whitening out the pathologist's report. Now when you look up, he tells you, "Sir, I googled lymphoma. It is almost like a cancer. My wife can't handle that diagnosis. She has always been a worried and frightened person. I want you to tell my wife that she had TB. She is waiting outside, doctor. I thought I will call her in after I had a chat about this with you." So the point of discussion is, can you hide the diagnosis from the patient? Does the patient have a right to know the diagnosis? Absolutely yes. You are bound by all your things to tell the exact diagnosis, the implications to the patient in whichever way you know, but you will have to. You cannot hide the diagnosis. Tomorrow the patient can file a legal notice to you. What should the patient be told about the diagnosis, therapy and prognosis? They should be told in a very clear but in a very soft way. How much should be told to a patient about their illness is very important. It is the right of the patient to ask a doctor that how much time it is left, because the patient has to take care of many things, okay, before he dies. Are there exceptions to full disclosure? Can the family members request withholding of information from the patient? So All of this have to have a discussion. So, and this can come as a question in next exams. So what would be your next? You will be given 4 or 5 options and you will have to select one option. So these are the kind of questions that can be asked to you. Seeking immunity. So for example, we all go through this situation. It was a busy clinical day and it was getting worse. The patients were getting impatient. The time was marching and details were becoming a casualty. 5-year-old Madhumita comes in with her mother. She has asthma and is under your care. You examine her and you adjust your prescriptions and you start your goodbyes. At that time, her mother reminds you that she is due for her booster shot. Booster means the vaccination, the immunization program. Oh, that you frown and tell her to wait for a few minutes and that you will have the nurse load the injection and come to the adjoining room and give the injection. You ask the nurse to load the injection and keep it for you over the intercom. Now you continue to see the patient. After a couple of patients, the mother knocks indicating that she is getting late. You get up and you go to the next room. The nurse is not there, but you find a loaded syringe. You quickly administer the injection to the child and get back to seeing patients. A few minutes later, the nurse calls back saying that she has loaded Madhumita's injections. You drop everything and you go into the injection room and confront the nurse. But doctor, that was the gentamicin I had loaded for Mrs. Asif. She says, so what has happened? There is a medical error that has taken place. So medical error in clinical care has occurred. So what is the correct exposure approach to the disclosure of medical error? Now you have made a mistake. The patient is there, the child is there, you have made an error. You did not make an error, you made an error by mistake. You did not know about it. Okay, so the consequence of the failure to disclosure of medical errors, including MLC and the loss of trust, all these things are very, very important points for discussion. And such questions will be asked to you in your next exam as well as in your university exams. Again, this is the last, I think last or second last. Now, don't not tell my wife. So what has happened over here that there is a husband and there is a wife. Okay, so the husband has been diagnosed with tuberculosis and he has gone for basic, testing. He has also given his blood sample and now he has tested positive for HIV. Now the doctor who is treating this patient who has tested positive for both TB and HIV, he has asked that your wife should be tested also because the husband is having a sexual relationship with his wife. So the husband, he becomes very angry and anxious. He says, no, I cannot, tell my wife to get tested because the husband has contracted HIV before his marriage to his wife because he had went for some sexual intercourse with some sexual encounter before his marriage 3 years before. And now the doctor is saying that he has to test the wife. Now the husband is scared and he is saying that no, do not tell my wife because if I tell she will leave me. And the husband is very frightened. So in this situation, what is the important thing is the confidentiality, the primacy of the doctor-patient confidentiality. So can the doctor disclose in such a situation? This is the problem. What does confidentiality entail? What is the spectrum? When can the confidence be breached? With whom and how? So can the doctor tell about this thing to the wife or no? So confidentiality and the disease that may engender the patients and the society. So all of these things are important points of discussion. So you have to read about them in details. Okay. This is again about the medical termination of pregnancy. Okay. So in a 16-year-old, if she has become pregnant, okay, and if the child wants to keep the baby with the patient, where the doctors can do not want to. So as far as I know in forensic and medicine, so up till 18 years of age, you are adolescents and all the decisions are taken by your parents. So you have to go and read your forensic medicine to see who makes the healthcare decisions for the adolescents and what are the medical implications of the MTP Act and are there provisions for any minors and should adolescents be included in the decision making process. So if you read this case history, you are going to understand the basic importance of the ethics and what all decisions you have to take. So these are all the basic the links to all the bioethics and all this ethical part, the ATCOM part. So there is an archive that you should go, the journal, and you should go the Universal Declaration of Human Rights. Okay, all the links have been provided to you. For now, the links for communication by Makul and Hossenberg And also Whitcomb has given you what does it mean to be a physician, and what is the by Eisenberg, also by Offrey. Okay, you have to go and see all these other, and all these links, these are not my links, these links have been provided by the National Medical Council in their books. I will give you all the shares have been shared to you, all the links have been provided in the description box. So thank you very much, guys. I hope you all have enjoyed this lecture. You have learned a lot from this lecture, and please do comment if in case of any doubt, and please don't forget to share with those in need. Thank you very much, guys. Stay tuned. I will be back with more lectures.